Well, welcome to worship. It is good to be gathered together here in church. Great to see all of you today as we kick off a new year here at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church. My name is Ben Hilding, one of the pastors here, along with Pastor Alicia Hilding back there. If you're new here and we haven't met you yet, we'd love to get to know you. And yes, same last name, we're married, we love each other, and life is good. All right, today marks a shift. We're recording the service because this upcoming weekend, then, the service will be online, on TV, on the radio, and in person all at the same time. We're doing that because we really strive to welcome. And this way, everybody, wherever you are, in person, online, worshiping remotely on TV or listening to the radio, we all hear the same message, same songs, the same week. So that's our effort to do that. So welcome to those of you who are worshiping remotely. It's good to be gathered and worship together. Perhaps you know this, but we have a little tradition around here. We like to kick off the new year with a kickoff video. All right, so buckle up your seatbelts. This year, we really do think it's going to be a good, good year. Enjoy.
I got a feeling that this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good, good year. A feeling that this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good, good year. This year's the year. Let's praise it up. I got my offering. Let's give it up. Go out, proclaim it. Like praise our God. This is a new year. Let's kick it off.
I know that we'll share the love if we keep in our hearts words from God above. I feel trust that I wanna let it go. Let's go worship together, filling up our souls.
Fill up the cup, drink. Get it, set it up. Look at them jamming. Just turn it up. Let's get our coffee, black or cream. We'll drink it down.
Drink it down.
Let's read the gospel.
And then we'll do it again.
Let's do it, let's do it, let's do it, let's do it. And do it, and do it. Let's praise it up and do it. And do it, and do it, do it, do it. Let's do it, let's do it, let's do it, do it, do it, do it.
Say a prayer, sing a song, praise never stop.
Stop, 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 stop.
See a friend, have a meal, God is on top.
Top, 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 top.
Feel the love, raise your voice, don't let it drop.
Drop, 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 drop.
Tell them how God is love.
On Sunday and Wednesday, but we share God's love Sunday through Sunday.
Get to church. You know what we say?
Praising every day, praising every day.
And I'm feeling
that this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good, good year. This year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good year. That this year's gonna be a good, good year.
All right, let's raise it up. Let's stand and join in our opening hymn, When the Saints Go Marching In.
Refuse to shine. Oh, when the sun refused to
I'm going to invite us all to rise for today's gospel reading from Luke chapter 10. After this, the Lord appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Go on your way. See, I'm sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house, and if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what's set before you, cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. We say, praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, once again, welcome to worship today as we gather to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. And today we're going to dive right in. We're going to dive right into the Gospels, and we're going to start off by talking, we're going to have the whole sermon talk about Jesus Christ. The Gospels start by focusing on Jesus. They're laser focused on this one person, this man born in Bethlehem, raised in Nazareth, who grows up and ministers around the Galilee region. In Luke chapter 4, he says his job is this: to bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free. And despite the fact that his hometown rejected him, people in need started looking for this man who said he would do these things. Like Simon Peter's mother-in-law, who was sick with a high fever. He healed her. So word about him spread. And soon the crowds began to look for him. So in Luke chapter 5, the next chapter, what does Jesus do then? He forms a team. He calls the first disciple, a fisherman by the name of Simon Peter. And you see, as Jesus became known, as people started learning about him, as people started hearing about him, he made this intentional shift. And if you ask me, this is a Christianity-defining shift. He wasn't interested in a popularity contest. Jesus wasn't looking to get votes or to win over fans. He simply cared about the people. He wanted to bring good news to the poor, to heal the sick. And so, he started building his team so that they could do that for the masses, for the crowds, most effectively. And as he called Simon Peter, he started to mentor him, and he showed him how to do just that. And he bowed his face to the ground and healed a man with leprosy. And then as he was teaching in a crowded home, there was a paralyzed man who he needed help. And his friends knew that the only way that they could get to Jesus is if they made a hole in the roof of the place and they lowered this man down. So that's what they did. And Jesus healed him. And then what did he do? He grew his team, calling a second team member, a tax collector by the name of Levi. And after this, Jesus kept on going. He started teaching about fasting and how to honor the Sabbath. Then a man whose hand was withered came to him, and Jesus healed him too. And then what did he do in chapter 6? He grew his team, choosing now 12 disciples who would follow him. Now here's an important note. There's a difference between a disciple and an apostle. A disciple is a follower or a learner. They're learning. That's a disciple, learning the disciplines. An apostle means to be sent out. An apostle is a sent out one. A disciple is a learner, and an apostle is a sent out one. So these 12 disciples came to learn and to be discipled. And for a few more chapters, Jesus taught them how to love the enemy, how not to judge others, but instead forgive them. Then he healed a servant of a Roman military leader, and there was a widow whose son had died, and he knew this was bad news for her, and so Jesus saw her, had compassion on her, and he made the son rise from the dead. And after this, there was a crew of people accusing this woman of being a sinner. They were going to stone her. And Jesus stooped down to the ground and drew something in the sand, and he said,
Let the one of you who's without sin throw the first stone. But no one could do that because they'd all sinned. And then what did Jesus do? In chapter 8, he grew his team. In addition to the 12 disciples becoming apostles, now a group of women joined as well. And again, as the crowds pressed in on him, Jesus taught them. He showed them how to do ministry. He calmed the storm. He healed many who were sick, like the man out in the Gerasene country infected with an overwhelming mental health challenge, or the woman who had been bleeding uncontrollably for 12 years, or the man whose daughter was dying. Jesus healed them all. And then what did he do after this? Think back with me. Chapter 5, crowds were coming. He grew his team, calling Simon Peter. Later that chapter, he grew his team, calling Levi. Then chapter 6 grew to 12 disciples. Then chapter 8, the ministry team grew beyond that to include a number of women. Now in chapter 9, after this period of watching and witnessing and learning to what Jesus did, chapter 9 says this. Then Jesus called the 12 and gave them a power and authority over all the demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out. Sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God. Folks, this is where the disciples became apostles. The learners became the sent out ones in chapter 9. And as a result, the crowd expanded exponentially. 5,000 people showed up, hungry. So Jesus fed them. Only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, he still fed them, and he taught them. And he healed the sick who were there. And in chapter 10, that's where we get today's reading, where we see what Jesus did next. And actually, can we pull that back up? Can we pull back up our reading, the beginning of the reading for today, the gospel reading? The Lord appointed how many others? 70. So 1 to 2 to 12, to including women. Then he sent out 12. And now because the crowd's growing and growing, he now appointed 70 others and sent them on ahead of them. He sent them out to be apostles, not just learners, but apostles to help those in need, to do his work. See, folks, Jesus wasn't worried about his own popularity or credit. He was worried about the people who were hurting. As his job description said at the onset of his ministry, he was worried about bringing good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to let the oppressed go free. And to do that, he needed a bigger team. He sent them out to ministry. If you continue reading, actually through the book of Acts, you'll see that once people saw how not everyone appreciated Jesus' unconditional love, they deserted him. But after Jesus' death and resurrection, the book of Acts is the book that follows the Gospel of Luke. And what happens is actually pretty much a very parallel process from the first part of Luke. This pattern happens again with Peter and Paul. In the book of Acts, the good news spread from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria to the ends of the earth, somehow finding its way to New Prague in 2023. Throughout the generations, the body of Christ has been a team sport, where followers learn from Jesus and then are sent out. They become his disciples, but then they're sent out as apostles to do God's work in the world from one generation to the next. We can go to the title slide now. Yeah. So today's week kick off this new year. I'm going to ask you a question. What do you need from church? What do you need at this time? And I don't want to oversimplify this point, but in each of these stories, I can't help but notice two groups of people. The apostles, or the disciples which became apostles, and the crowds. The apostles were asked to help with the mission and ministry of Jesus. They stepped up, and as word spread, they were sent out to do what Jesus himself did, to teach and to heal and to share the good news of God's love for all people. They did what Jesus did. Jesus gave them authority, said, help me out. People are hurting. I need you. As Karen mentioned in the announcements, today we want to invite you to take a look at your bulletin. We conveniently prepared a whole page here. So if you open it up, on this inside flap, there's a Be a Part of the HTLC community. If you're worshiping online, this can be found online as well. There's a QR code for all of this online. This is a list of opportunities to serve. So when I ask you, what do you need from the church today? If you feel so called, folks, the church has a lot of opportunities of ways to serve. Locally, here at this church, the church needs each of these roles filled. And I want to walk through them just quickly. If you take a look, there's a place for a name, phone number, email if you prefer Wednesday or Sunday. If you're online, you can circle both. Worship, every service we have entails a lot of help. So if you want to help either by serving as an usher or serving communion when we do that or reading scripture like Jess did so wonderfully or helping with the slide presentation or helping prepare communion at the altar guild, maybe you want to help with music in some way, either singing or playing an instrument. Maybe you want to be a part of the choir or the bell choir, which we just may happen to have two this year, one on Sunday, one on Wednesday. Or maybe you can help out with children, youth, and family ministry. We need help, folks. We've got opportunities to serve with crew time, which is happening now. We've got chances to help mentor high school students. We got our confirmation leaders covered, which is great. But we still need help with special events on an as-needed basis. Maybe you can't help regularly, but as needed. Or if you're like, school year's tough, but I can help in the summer, there's VBS. If you're looking to get connected with a group of people, to really get to know a group of people, grow in relationship with them, build the community, but also serve in a particular way, there's all these ministry teams, each having different ways to help out. The Acts of Kindness team, the Children, Youth, and Family team that oversees those ministries, the Hospitality team making meals on a regular basis, quilting, mission outreach, distributing our tithe as a congregation, the Prayer Shawl team helping comfort those who are hurting, or the Racial Justice team we heard about in announcements. All those teams, if you feel a certain passion or call, we need help. Or if you say, you know what, my realm is leadership, I'd love to serve as a leader. We've got these leadership roles, but they're elected through our nominating committee process. As a congregation, we vote on that then in January. But if you'd consider it, if you'd consider being open to that, you can fill one of those boxes as well, either as church council, endowment, nominating team, serving as a representative of this church at the Minneapolis Synod Assembly or on the audit team. Or if you got another idea, you're like, they didn't put this down, but the church really needs this. We couldn't fit it all. You can tell we kind of ran out of space as it is. You can put the other box, lots of ways to serve. You'll notice in the description, you can fill this out tonight. You can find pencils around. You can write it down. You can put it in the offering plate when we pass the offering plates around. As Karen mentioned in the announcements, at the Welcome Center back there, there's this little drop-off box, or you scan your QR code and do that. You can do it right now. You can take it home and think about it. These are all ways to serve. As I mentioned, the church isn't made up of professional believers where there's a certain group that's more religious and better. No. It's made up of real human beings, you and me, in need of God's grace and empowered somehow still to do God's work in the world. That's the church, and there's no way around it. As we begin a new year, we need help. If you'd be willing to help, we'd love to know how you might feel called to serve. But you might notice there's another box at the bottom of the bulletin. It says crowd. As I mentioned, as I read the Gospels in preparation for today, I was struck. Remember, I said there's two groups of people that I notice on a regular basis, the apostles and the crowds. And it seems to me like Jesus treated them differently. He taught the disciples, he mentored them, and then sent them out as apostles. But when the crowds came to him, Jesus had compassion on them. He sent out the apostles, but he had compassion on the crowd. He taught them, he healed them, he loved them. But he didn't force them to do things in return for him. He had compassion on them. So here's my other part of the invitation. Think about what you need at this time. Because sometimes we all need to be a part of the crowd. The crowd's a place for people who are hurting, people who come to Jesus for healing, or people just coming to learn, to listen what Jesus is teaching. If you feel like you just need some good news, maybe you're dealing with an illness or a challenge in your life, or you're just overwhelmed and hungry for rejuvenation from God, or perhaps you're new to this learning from Jesus thing, there's no shame in being a part of the crowd. For in the crowd, Jesus has compassion. Sometimes we all need that. Sometimes we may get asked to be an apostle when we really just need to be a part of the crowd right now, but ask me again in a little while. So, if that's you right now, I want the church to not have any judgment, but only compassion for you, just like Jesus did. So feel free to click or to check off the crowd box if you say, I just need some compassion right now. We understand. As we begin this new year, 2023, think about what you need. And I'm not just saying that. What do you need from church? What do you need from God? Are you energized and ready to step up, ready to help the church in an important way this year? If so, we would love to have your help. We'd love to welcome you to the team of us trying to do our best to share God's love from one generation to the next, trying to be faithful apostles. Or are you tired or hurting or learning right now? If so, join the crowd. It's a place of healing and compassion. Just as Jesus commissioned the apostles, he had compassion for the crowds. And I do believe that in the same way that this God is here as we worship to listen to what we need this year, whether it's compassion or a commission, may the God of grace and glory give us all what we need as we kick off this new year as well. For that we say thanks be to God. Amen. And you are a God of compassion. So we thank you for always being present to hear the concerns, the challenges, and the heaviness we carry in our hearts. We lift to you today those we know who need your loving care. Benita, Al, Eric, Kayla, Sarah, Brenda, Carol, Joel, Tasha, and Brad.
Listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us love, send us grace.
God of commissions, you call us to be your apostles, to serve your people in this world, each in our own ways. Stir in us the hunger to help. And as we begin a new year, may this church respond to your calling for us in faithfulness, diligence, and love. Gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now we go to share God's love for all people from one generation to the next. As you do, be comforted in knowing that Christ goes with you. May he go before you to show you the way, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you watching over you, and within you to give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, let's sing.
Peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.